After decades of active SETI searches, it's tempting to say that we appear to be alone. The problems there, however, are in the numbers. In an observable universe that contains, and think about this, one followed by 24 zeros, star systems, it seems unlikely that we would be alone. That this single planet, in one single galaxy itself, among 2 trillion others, would be the only one with life is beyond unlikely, to the point that science itself goes off kilter, in that there no longer is a mediocrity or Copernican principle to rely on. We'd have to reckon with this planet, actually, for some reason, being very special, and having won the highest possible lottery odds in the universe. If you factor in the universe at large, the flat geometry of it possibly suggesting that it's infinite in extent, and we assume it's much the same outside of our observable bubble, it becomes increasingly impossible to be alone. In an infinite universe, it simply becomes impossible, given the infinite chances for a second occurrence. Indeed, it becomes a matter of infinite occurrences at that point. This leads us to the continuing question, if intelligent alien life is common, then why don't we see it everywhere? There are obviously many possible answers to this, a great many of which I have covered on this channel. But a more recent line of thinking is that maybe in our speculations on the solutions to the Fermi paradox, we've missed the simplest answer. In short, we've only recently become interesting. This, of course, involves radio. Many make the argument that the reason SETI hasn't seen any verifiable technological signals from alien intelligences is because aliens no longer use radio, and instead favor some other means of communications, perhaps involving physics we don't yet know anything about. But this suffers a problem. Radio is cheap and easy. You can emit it without expending too much energy. This may not be the case with something like gravitational wave communications. While there may be advantages to it, it may just require too much mass and energy to ever be practical. After all, you can roast a chicken with a thermonuclear bomb. Physics lets you do it. But it comes with a lot of baggage, and when a standard fire, the same as we have built since the dawn of humanity, works just as well. All you need is wood instead of plutonium. And fire has never gone obsolete. Maybe a radio never does either. Especially with radar, which has no really good alternative in nature. So why don't we see alien transmissions everywhere? The reason may be really simple. There aren't any powerful transmitters pointed at us. SETI currently takes shots in the dark, hoping for some leakage of internal communications that might be powerful enough to see, or coming across an intentional signal by sheer chance. Newer SETI experiments will be coming online in the future that take a broader approach, and search large swaths of the sky instead of targeted stars, but they all suffer from the weak signal problem. All alien signals we currently can see might simply be below our detection threshold. And as usual with anything SETI, we can take a look at our own radio for some insight. It simply gets weaker and weaker the further you go from Earth. And other than some radar, most of our signals at a distance would be extremely weak. Aliens may not yet know about us, both because of distance, our radio has only propagated out to a radius of about 100 light years at this point, but also because of our weakness. Unless someone is monitoring Earth 24/7 with an enormous radio telescope, they might just easily miss us. In a paper by Omri Wandel, link in the description below, a new take on the Fermi paradox is advanced. In a nutshell, we should expect to see nothing, because we've just arrived on the scene. This rests on one reality. In the past, and in science fiction, we've always looked at the big picture for aliens. Gigantic Kardashev Type 3 civilizations that control the energy of entire galaxies. But there does not seem to be one in this galaxy. It still looks fully natural. Nor do we see anything in nearby galaxies. So maybe instead of expecting all-powerful aliens, maybe they're simply practical and live within their means. It may simply be that building von Neumann probes are just too expensive in materials and development, with too many star systems to cover. And it may be better to just build very large radio telescopes and listen, especially space-based interferometers that can have an effective size of an entire star system, from which to collect very sensitive data and look for weak signals. Given the current radio radius of Earth's emissions, it's entirely possible that the answer to the Fermi paradox is that no one has seen us yet. As our signals propagate outward, the chances for being picked up by an alien civilization rises. While there may not be anyone within 100 light years, the chances of there being someone within 1,000 light years is much greater. 2,000, far more. But that's not the only issue. The other problem is the return time needed for a message. This radius is even smaller, so an alien civilization 100 light years out detects us right now and decides to send a signal back. They may or may not have a transmitter that can do it, so it may take them decades longer to build it. Once they're ready, the soonest we can expect a message back is at least in a century, probably more. That's if they choose to respond at all. Rather, they may be listeners that play it safe and go radio silent as best they can once they realize there's someone else in their neighborhood. But with distance comes a degree of safety. If you're 1,000 light years away, then it's less likely that sending a hello signal will get you invaded. But that also means that we have almost 2,000 years before we'll hear anything from such a civilization. So it should not really be that surprising that we haven't heard from an alien civilization unambiguously in radio, and we should caution against getting too impatient to prematurely dismiss the paradox. And there is another aspect of this. It's possible that aliens are transmitting in radio, but using a different means. That sat relatively neglected in SETI because it's too hard to look for. Conventional wisdom in SETI goes like this. You pick a frequency that might have some natural signpost that aliens would be aware of, such as the 21-centimeter hydrogen line. You then listen with the channels of your receiver sliced into very narrow bands. You then look for narrowband signals, especially those limited to one channel. And since nature does not readily produce such signals, if you see one, it's likely artificial in nature. But that's not the only way to make a technological signal. The second technique is something we might not even see if it were right in front of us. In telecommunications, there is the concept of spread spectrum technology. This is a technique, or group of techniques, where a normally narrowband signal is spread or smeared across frequencies, having the effect of a wider bandwidth, or jumps around in frequency. This is really useful in secure communications, and also favors signals against noise, jamming, interference, and so on. This technology can also be really hard to spot, unless you know very specifically what you're looking for. It's essentially useful for clandestine communications. Raw radio telescope data in SETI experiments is messy. You can see this in the famous WOW signal printout. The low numbers you see populating the page are noise. Anything 3 and below is just not workable. Going up from that, 4, maybe something. 5, a little more likely. 6EQ UJ5 with a 6 and a 7 stepping up from the base frequency is ridiculously strong and weird, even if it were Earth interference. That said, it shows that weak signals will get lost in the noise. And other than WOW, the signal candidates have tended to be very weak. As a result, radio astronomers in SETI built a toolkit to wade through all the noise, such as the fast Fourier transform. The problem is that these techniques might not readily pick out obscured signals like spread spectrum. That may mean we're simply missing signals because nearby aliens are stealthy. This may dramatically improve, however, with the advent of quantum computing and artificial intelligence. Those methods might make searches of old data far easier than we can do right now, meaning that we may have picked up alien signals in the past, we just didn't have the computing power to identify them. It could even be the computers are the gateway to first contact. The idea that we may be of no interest to an alien civilization until we hit some specific technology is an old one. Arthur C. Clarke's short story, The Sentinel, is just such a story, which set the stage for the much more extensive 2001, but in a different form. We have often thought of one possible indicator like this as the detonation of nuclear weapons. When we did that, starting with the Trinity test blast of 1945, it has been suggested that maybe we caught someone's attention with it. Another example from sci-fi was Star Trek First Contact, where due to the Prime Directive, the Vulcans did not make contact until they saw warp signature. There, it was only when a species became not just space-faring, but had a method to rapidly cross the vast distances of interstellar space, were they of interest and had come of age, and safe to contact without damaging their civilization. But there are other candidates for this gateway. One I've mentioned before is generalized artificial intelligence, and that aliens remain stealthy, yet function as a police force, ready to intervene and stop civilizations from developing this technology because it may prove a threat to the galaxy at large. A sci-fi example here is the Geth from Mass Effect. Had the Quarians been stopped from developing that tech, they wouldn't have gotten themselves into a pickle, and no one else in the galaxy would need to have shootout battles with their machines. But there is another potential gatekeeper, that of quantum computers, a road we are now actively going down. One virtue of quantum computers, and a curse at the same time depending on your perspective, is that they are the best code breakers we will ever have. They pose a very clear threat to any kind of encryption we now use, should we be able to bring them to their fullest extent. It may be that to see an alien signal at all and pick it out from the noise, you need a quantum computer, and that provides the aliens a method of stealth until they can be reasonably certain we are technologically advanced enough to handle knowing about their presence. But let's take it from an alien perspective and do a thought experiment along these lines. Hypothetically speaking, say we caught a close radio signal from a planet, say from the Alpha Centauri system just under 5 light years away. This would tell us two things. One is that there is someone there, and two, that either intelligent life in the universe is unbelievably common, or there is a galaxy-spanning civilization at work in the Milky Way colonizing all suitable planets, or is in the process of doing so. But if we have proof that there is someone there, then what might we do? This cannot be predicted. On the one hand, we might do everything we can to go radio silent and try to cloak our world with lasers, to make it look like there's no civilization here. We do that. If you want to hide something, cover it in camo. But we also do reconnaissance, and work is afoot to build a swarm of tiny light sails driven by laser towards the Alpha Centauri system to explore it. One merely needs time to wait for them to get there at some fraction of the speed of light. The concept is solid. We can take pictures and measurements from another star system, as long as we budget the time. But if we saw a radio signal from that system, would that accelerate our development of such efforts? Would we have a greater motivation to do it, since we might be able to glimpse and perhaps interact with aliens? What would the aliens think of a swarm of reconnaissance micro-spacecraft passing through photographing their system, like a foreign spy balloon over superpower? Where does bad first contact go from there? It just goes to show, close aliens are not necessarily a good thing, whether the aliens are us or someone else. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about carnivorous plants, having recently viewed some Venus flytraps in the rare plant store. Yes, I frequent one of those. What if passive plant life in the universe isn't the norm, and that the universe teems with photosynthetic carnivores, and aliens in the know serve as exterminators? The moment the plants of an exoplanet appear to get out of hand, it's curtains. And since photosynthetic plants are one of the strongest biosignatures out there, well, let's just say we've already been betrayed. Plants are not our friend, but I've known that for a while due to interactions with rosebush thorns. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.